Welcome, I'm Peter Knox. I'm the director of the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities here at Case Western Reserve. I want to invite you also at the conclusion of the talk to ask questions, offer comments. But if you do, please make your way to the microphone in the middle of the room, because we are recording the event and your questions won't be picked up if you don't speak into the mic. So, welcome to this year's Walter A. Strauss Lecture. This series honors a teacher and a scholar whose intellectual passions reflect the university's long tradition in the humanities. Walter Strauss was born in Mannheim, Germany in 1923, and he came to the US in the late 1930s. He joined the faculty here at CWRU in 1970 as the first Elizabeth and Walter C. Treuhaft Professor of Humanities in the Department of Modern Languages and Literature. A revered and award-winning teacher, after his retirement and until his death in 2008, Professor Strauss continued to offer courses and seminars, both at the university and in his home, that attracted numerous and devoted students and faculty. This lecture series is made possible by the endowment established by Paul Wurzberger, a longtime resident of Cleveland. He and his wife, Odette, were strong advocates for the arts and generous benefactors of this university. The endowment that Paul Wurzberger established makes possible the Walter A. Strauss Lectureship in the Humanities and commemorates Professor Strauss's lasting contribution to the goals Wurzberger cherished. This year's Strauss lecturer, Robert Darnton, comes to us from a little-known school outside Boston, where he is the Carl H. Pforzheimer University Professor Emeritus and University Librarian Emeritus at Harvard University. The emeritus designation is very recent, since Professor Darnton was only promoted from active service a little over a year ago. His career at Harvard began as an undergraduate and was interrupted only by 4 years of graduate study at Oxford and 39 years on the faculty of Princeton University. Over that time, and in the years since he returned to Harvard in 2007, Professor Darnton has contributed a steady stream of books, papers, and articles, both in learned journals and more popular media. Among the many distinguished titles in the list of his publications are The Business of Enlightenment in 1979, one of his earlier forays into the history of the book, The Great Cat Massacre and Other Episodes in French Cultural History, published in 1984, The Forbidden Bestsellers of Pre-Revolutionary France from 1995, and in 2009, The Art of Slander in France from Louis XIV to Napoleon. The common thread in these and the other 23, or is it 24, books that he has written, edited, or co-edited, as well as the scores of articles that he has authored, is a genuinely humane sensibility harnessed to a reportorial spirit of inquiry, an earnest desire to make sense of the past so that we can be sensible about the present. As a cultural historian with a particular interest in 18th century France, Professor Darnton has had an impact on historical studies that extends far beyond his area of specialization. He has earned the right to be briefly embarrassed here by a recitation of some of the awards that have marked his career, because they are many and they are richly deserved. They include a MacArthur Prize Fellowship, a National Book Critics Circle Award, and election to the French Legion of Honor. In 2012, President Obama presented him with a National Humanities Medal, and in the following year, he was the recipient of the Del Duca World Prize in the Humanities, awarded by the Institut de France. His tenure as university librarian at Harvard has been distinguished by a series of remarkable achievements in defense of the free exchange of ideas. In spite of occasionally being bushwhacked by provostial predations, as one of his colleagues at Harvard recently remarked to me, they talk like that at Harvard. Not only has he been successful in beating back Google's attempt to corner the market on knowledge in 2007, he's been a pioneer in expanding free public access to scholarship through the web platform known as DASH, or Digital Access to Scholarship at Harvard, a centralized open access library of research by members of the Harvard community. And surely some future historian of the caliber of Robert Darnton will acknowledge the landmark achievement that is the Digital Public Library of America, a platform that links more than 1,200 libraries, archives, and museums to make more than 10 million items available free online. Professor Darnton's recent work and the subject of his lecture here today draws on his passion for history and for the book to investigate state processes that seek to manipulate both. There could hardly be a more timely subject these days when truth is treated as a marketable commodity and history, like seemingly everything else, is up for negotiation. This evening, Professor Darnton will share with us some of his thoughts on these subjects in his paper, Censors at Work, How States Shape Literature. Please join me in welcoming this year's Walter A. Strauss lecturer, Robert Darnton.
Thank you for embarrassing me, Professor Knox. I would like to thank you, everyone, for coming here. It is really a great honor to be here to celebrate the memory of Professor Strauss, to be part of your Humanities Center. I'm dazzled by the richness of the cultural institutions all gathered together here. It's simply amazing. I've spent a happy afternoon at the art gallery. So I am truly thankful. My subject might seem simple, and that's the problem, because the study of censorship usually falls into the problem of looking too simple. It pits oppression against freedom of speech. But if you look at it harder, it becomes more complicated and full of surprises. Having studied it under three authoritarian regimes, I think we should rethink our understanding of censorship in general. Now, first, you might think we should begin with a definition. But I believe that defining censorship at the outset represents what the French call une question mal posée, a badly put question. The kind of thing that could orient research in the wrong direction by reifying censorship as if it were a thing in itself, you know, something like a substance that could be traced through the bloodstream of any body politic. Instead of a definition, I would like to begin with a question, one that was put by my favorite sociologist, Irving Goffman, as advice at the outset of any inquiry: what is going on here? Therefore, I want to get inside the workings of censorship systems, to consult the censors themselves about what they did or do and how they understand it, and then to try to see a pattern of behavior as it fits into a larger social and political system. So you could call this anthropological history. Anthropological history requires a rich run of documents, heavy fieldwork in the archives, not dozens of documents, but hundreds and hundreds. And to lead to a general conclusion, I think it should be comparative. So I will discuss three case studies and attempt to combine ethnographic analysis with comparative history. The three are Bourbon France in the 18th century, British India in the 19th century, Communist East Germany in the 20th century. That is three authoritarian regimes. And I should add that I'm studying the censorship of books, not of newspapers, television, the internet, and the rest. So let's first consider France. Here you see a title page of a typical legal French book. It could be any book. I don't know how well you can make it out. There's a lot that could be said for it, but I would like you to concentrate on the very bottom line with approbation and the privilege of the king. Privileges function as early modern versions of copyright, but they belong to a completely different conceptual universe, derived from the Latin for private law, privilege has conferred certain rights on an individual or group that were denied to others. Privileges existed everywhere and at every level of the Ancien Régime in France. In the case of books, a privilege conveyed an exclusive right to sell the text. The person who enjoyed that right was privileged in himself as a bookseller. The law required that only booksellers could sell books. And furthermore, he belonged to a privileged corporation, a guild, which collectively benefited from certain exclusive rights, such as immunity from taxation. So books participated in the world of privilege in three ways: as texts, through booksellers, and in relation to the guild system. They epitomized the entire regime. Now, in order to receive a privilege, a book had to be approved by one or more censors. And in fact, if you look at any 18th century books, you will see the approbations and the privilege actually printed in the books themselves. Now, I don't expect you can read this, but it's just to show you, and I have little arrows pointing to interesting passages, it's to show you how seriously the whole concept of privilege and approbation is embodied by books. So if you read these approbations, I think they are quite interesting because they illustrate the criteria used by censors in clearing a book for a privilege. In this case, one censor remarked, quote, "I had pleasure in reading it. It is full of fascinating things," end quote. Another censor stressed its usefulness for travelers, it's about the French West Indies, and for students of botany, and he especially praised its style. A third censor simply attested that the book was a good read. He could not put it down. It inspired in the reader, he wrote, quote, "that sweet but avid curiosity that makes us want to continue further," end quote. Well, is this the language you would expect from a censor? I think we should go back to Irving Goffman's question, what is going on here? To answer that question, we need to get beyond, of course, the title pages of books and into the actual functioning of censors. They were organized in a branch of the central administration called the Direction de la Librairie. It employed the censors and oversaw every aspect of the book trade, and fortunately, it generated an enormous archive. Lots of paperwork, these documents can be studied carefully in order to understand how censors actually operated within the peculiar mechanism of the 18th century French state. While vetting manuscripts, they actually exchanged hundreds of letters, memos, in-house memos, talking to one another. So by reading through piles of bureaucratic paperwork, you get a sense of how they actually did their jobs. When they submitted memos favoring the granting of a privilege, the censors often wrote texts that read like book reviews. I'm just giving you examples of the paperwork. Don't worry if you can't make it out. My point is there was lots of it, and it's highly organized, often in printed forms that are then filled out by hand. So they emphasize, while sending memos to one another, matters of style and substance, and they pointed out the passages that, in their view, needed rewriting. But the unfavorable memos, when they refused a privilege, make especially good reading. They almost never mention any offense to the state, the church, or morality. No, because books that offended in that way would never have been submitted to the censors in the first place. They would have been sent to Amsterdam or Geneva to be printed outside of France and smuggled in the kingdom. In explaining their negative judgments, the censors also stressed questions of quality rather than ideology. One memo concluded, quote, "It is a compilation without taste and without discernment," end quote. Another rejected a defense of religious orthodoxy simply because it was badly done. Quote, "It is not a book at all. You cannot tell what the author's purpose is until you have finished it. He advances in one direction, then doubles back. His arguments are often weak and superficial. His style, in an attempt to be lively, merely becomes petulant. In the effort to turn a pretty phrase, he frequently looks silly and ridiculous," end quote. So that's the way the censors talk about their job. They were often men of letters themselves, like the authors whose works they censored. They often knew those authors and even suggested changes to improve the manuscripts. Their main concern, as one of them put it, was, in French he said, "défendre l'honneur de la littérature française," to defend the honor of French literature. That's what he thought he was doing. So censorship was essentially positive in 18th century France. It was the royal stamp of approval necessary to get a privilege for a book. Now, of course, there was more to it than that. This is just more examples of the paperwork to give you some of the flavor. By 1789, this administrative branch, the Direction de la Librairie, had developed into a large bureaucracy, and it included nearly 200 censors. Most of them received no payment for their work, but their position could lead to sinecures, patronage, and pensions. That's how the old regime worked in general. To be listed as censeur du roi in the royal almanac was an honor. People were proud of it, and it was a title that they bore with pride. But while accumulating prestige, the censors struggled under a heavy load of paperwork. So here they are filling out forms. I will spare you the details, but you can see lots of numbers that are cross-references from one register to another register. It's all quite elaborate, and sometimes you have to work through some rather painful handwriting. They followed elaborate procedures, but it's not about repression. It's rather about bureaucratization. In fact, it was in the middle of the 18th century that the word bureaucrat, was first developed in the French language. However, should this all sound too innocent, I should mention a final factor, post-publication censorship. Some books with approbations and privileges were circulating and then offended the authorities, sometimes in the state, especially in the church. They caused protests, polemics, and scandals. The most famous was, of course, connected with the great Encyclopédie of Diderot and d'Alembert. There was also the affair of De l'Esprit by Helvétius. So occasionally, there were explosions of indignation when the censors seemed to be too permissive. But it's quite fair to say that the Enlightenment in general was largely a struggle against censorship. As I said, most works of the Enlightenment were printed outside of France, smuggled in, and distributed through a highly organized and very economically efficient underground. Post-publication censorship mainly was an attempt to repress such books. Not only philosophical works connected with a famous philosophe, but also libels against the government and what today we call pornography. Actually, that's another word that did not exist in the 18th century. France had a book police with highly trained inspecteurs de la librairie, inspectors of the book trade, who raided bookshops, carried authors and publishers off to the Bastille. And contrary to what some historians have maintained, the Bastille was no three-star hotel. No one was tortured in it during the 18th century, but its prisoners suffered terribly. I've spent months and months in the papers of the archives of the Bastille, and you can see lives that are completely destroyed by several months of imprisonment. So I would emphasize that although formally censorship was positive, it also was repressive. It definitely had a dark side. Now I would like to skip over two centuries and talk about communist East Germany. I had the good fortune to spend a very interesting year, 1989 to 1990, in the Institute for Advanced Study in West Berlin. I got to know some East German authors and publishers, and soon after the fall of the wall on November 9th, 1989, they said to me, "You know, you keep talking about censorship as you studied it in 18th century France. Would you like to meet some censors?" "Yes," I said, "you bet I would," because as publishers, they were regularly dealing with the censorship office. So one thing led to another, and pretty soon I was in the office of two censors at 90 Clara Zetkin Straße in East Germany, just a few yards really from the Berlin Wall, which was still standing, although the state had collapsed, the Communist Party had collapsed, and the censors showed up for work, but they had no work to do because the whole system had come crashing down. So they understood that I was not on a witch hunt. I just wanted to understand how they did their job. It was a little awkward at first. There were two of them, and one, Hans-Jürgen Wesener, said to me as we started our conversation, "You have censorship in your country." "Oh," I said, "yes. It's the marketplace." Well, I knew that argument, so I said, okay, but you're a censor. How do you understand censorship? How would you define it, even though I'm not a great believer in definitions?" He answered with one word: planning. Literature should be planned, like everything in a socialist system. It's a matter of social engineering. And then he reached into a drawer of his desk and he pulled out a little thick document, which was the plan for East German literature in the year 1990. He gave me a copy of it, which I spent a lot of time studying later. This is the first page. I found it absolutely fascinating because there you got an account of every single book in East German literature that was supposed to be published in the year 1990, a year that never existed in the history of East German literature. So when I studied the plan, I got really a very interesting view of how social engineering applied to literature actually operated. Wesener also reached into his desk and then drew out another document. It's got a long German title, Themenplan Einschätzung, which means the ideological justification for the plan as it was addressed to the Central Committee of the Communist Party. So the censors not only drew up a plan that was to be executed in the publication of every single book in East German literature, they had to defend the plan to whom? To the Communist Party. So as in all communist countries in the good old days of the Cold War, the East Germany was divided in, the regime really is divided into two parts. On the very top of the broken line, you have the Communist Party with the supreme head of the whole system, Erich Honecker. And then below the broken line, you've got the state administration, a separate administration with a variety of ministries, as in most governments. And they're divided, and you see at the bottom two lines, the subdivisions where the censors actually operated. So these censors prepared their plan. Their boss, a man called Klaus Herpke, who was a deputy minister of culture, would take the plan under his arm and go over to another part of East Berlin to the Central Committee of the Communist Party, which had a division called Kultur, culture. Culture, in the apparatus of the party, was a group of about 20 specialists in surveying what the people in the government did. And they were led by a dragon lady called Ursula Ragwitz. So Herpke would defend his plan to Frau Ragwitz, or I should say Comrade Ragwitz, and sometimes they would insist that this book would be taken out or the emphasis should be somewhat different. Herpke would return to the censorship office. One thing would lead to another, and finally the plan would be set into operation. So the censors, as they described all of this to me, insisted that they were trying to defend the honor of East German literature, kind of like the French before them. They wanted quality, and in fact, they were very well-educated people. There were two of them. They both had doctorates in German literature. They knew Goethe and Schiller backwards and forwards. They were highly intelligent and cultivated. They were also good party members. The supreme value or value in the party system, they summarized in a loaded word, Parteilichkeit. Loyalty to the party line. So, of course, they defended the party line. They wouldn't accept anything that went against it. But at the same time, they cared about quality. So they had sort of two pressures, a double pressure on them as they approved books. But they told me they sympathized with many of the authors whose works they censored. So what did censoring come down to in actual practice as operated by these two censors that I met? Could they give me examples, I asked. Well, they said, you know, actually, we didn't cross out too many lines because the books had been censored before they even arrived here. But for example, the word ecology, absolutely verboten because of the enormous pollution in East German cities. It was really staggering. Another word that they did not allow in the texts when they did actual blue penciling was the word critical, because it suggested there might be dissenters in the GDR. Or a third, the phrase the 1930s, not allowed. It might suggest Stalinism, and it had to be replaced by the first half of the 20th century. So there were various things like this that they did, but in fact, as they insisted, most of the censoring took place in publishing houses before the final manuscript arrived in the censor's office. Editors acted as censors while giving manuscripts a professional going over, and most important, the authors censored themselves. Self-censorship, I think, was at the heart of the system. Authors almost never turned in finished manuscripts. Unlike most of you, you write a book, you turn it into to the publisher. That didn't happen in East Germany. Instead, you go to an editor. The editor is a member of the Communist Party. The head of the publishing house is a highly placed apparatchik. And the editor is also acting as a censor, making sure that nothing untoward anything against Parteilichkeit might be in the book that you are in the process of writing. So you negotiate over that book chapter by chapter, often paragraph by paragraph, and when it finally is put together, with the editor acting as a virtual collaborator, it's pretty pure as far as the party line is concerned. So there is this process of negotiation, of compromise, of complicity on the part of authors and censors. The top people in the system, the nomenklatura, were directors of publishing houses, chief editors of reviews, or high administrators in the culture ministry. So they all knew each other. It was a fairly small world of highly placed apparatchiks whose careers could interchange with lateral transfer of individuals. Also, as far as I could tell, they were true believers. Like their French counterparts, they thought that censorship was positive, a way of constructing a socialist society. Now, they acknowledged that the system had faults. It involved compromise and complicity at every point, but they continued, they thought it was superior to the operations of the marketplace in capitalist societies. And anyhow, it was a fundamental reality which they had to accept, the way the world in which they operated was constructed. Now, I realized, of course, that a great deal of self-justification went into this self-description, so I wasn't so naive that I just thought this is wonderful social engineering, and isn't it great that the censors appreciate Goethe and Schiller? They were facing, of course, an uncertain future because the two Germanies had not yet been united and there was no East German state at that point. So naturally, they wanted to describe their functions in a favorable light. And as a historian, I was trained to be skeptical about everything, all information. So to put their remarks in perspective, I decided I would have to go to the archives. And I simply walked over to the archives of the Central Committee of the Communist Party located near Alexanderplatz in East Berlin. They too had never seen an American. I mean, these people had never set foot in West Berlin, and to see this strange animal walking in the door and saying, could I consult your archives, please, was very strange for them. These were the archives of the Central Committee of the Communist Party. Well, they didn't really know what to do with me, so they said, okay, and I began filling out forms and boxes of documents would arrive. Some of the documents, it's a long story, I won't go into the details, but some of them showed that the two censors I had been interviewing actually participated in purges, and that their boss, this head of the censorship office, Klaus Höpke, he was their hero. He had a strong Stalinist streak, which you could see very clearly in the archives. Just one example, in 1978, he wrote a memo opposing a proposal to publish the works of Kierkegaard. Quote, if Kierkegaard belongs to our literary heritage, then so do Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, Freud. Besides, in deciding what can be published from late bourgeois philosophy, we want first of all to take into account the situation in the ideological class war. We have had enough of individualistic attitudes to life and lifestyles, end quote. So, Kierkegaard was not permitted at all in East Germany, nor were Freud, Nietzsche, Schopenhauer, Kafka, all the writers that we connect with modernism, but what they called late bourgeois literature. Now, the system involved plenty of banning and pulping of books, along with spying, denunciations, and manipulation of all kinds. The office of Kurt Hager, who was really the number two person, he's the second name under Erich Honecker, he was the party's ideological chief. He he kept a list that I came across of requests from authors who wanted favorable treatment. It was very fascinating, a whole box of requests from authors. What did they want? A better apartment. The ability to buy a car. There was long lines. You had to wait years to get one of these little Trabis. They wanted sometimes to be able to read West German periodicals. They wanted to get a son or sometimes a daughter into a university. And above all, they wanted to travel to the West. Many, many authorizations for travel. So there were carrots and sticks, a lot of carrots, that could be used by the regime to control authors. Most of the documents I consulted actually came from the 1980s. Right after the war, the system was much more brutal. There was actually a gulag system, and authors were killed. The worst episodes in the recent past were the Walter Janke affair of 1956, which led to a Stalinist purge, and the Wolf Biermann affair of 1976, which led to another purge and a wave of emigration to West Germany. In later years, control was less brutal but more pervasive, thanks to the growing power of the Stasi, or secret police. Control was also exerted by the censors and party officials through careful doses of these favors and also through threats and punishment. So in following the leads through the office of Kurt Hager, the person in charge of ideology and propaganda, I concentrated on the files of several prominent writers, such as Volker Braun, the playwright and novelist, who had a reputation for pushing the envelope too hard, that is, making veiled criticisms of the regime, although he was a loyal Communist Party member. One example of how the censors manipulated Braun came from a report on a meeting held on January 7th, 1976. So these really top bosses in the world of culture, Herbke Ragwitz and the culture minister, Joachim Hoffmann, they gathered together to discuss a problem. How are we going to handle this young playwright who keeps slipping veiled criticisms of the party into his plays and his novels? They agreed that he was talented. They needed him, above all, because of the influence that he wielded over the younger generation. So they did not want to make a dissident out of him. They say this explicitly in the minutes of their meeting. As they put it, they had to find a way to, quote, bind him to us, end quote, by the use of the carrot and the stick. So they would require him to make a public disavowal of left-wing deviationism and of his adherence to the party line. They would refuse to allow any discussion, reviews of his works in the press, but they would permit him to subscribe to Die Zeit, the West German publication. They would publish an edition of his collected plays, and they would send him to Cuba to get a good suntan. Actually, he was doing research for a play that he was writing on Che Guevara. The play turned into a spectacular debacle. The censors negotiated over the text of the play with Braun for several months, and you can follow it very precisely, word for word. They even got him to completely rewrite the first and the last scenes of this play. And the scenes in their original drafts actually made it seem as though Guevara was a hero who went off to continue the revolution in Bolivia while Fidel Castro remained back in Havana in charge of a big bureaucracy that was becoming more and more ossified. The moral of the story could be easily applied to East Germany. But the story itself horrified the Cuban ambassador, who came storming in to the offices of the Central Committee of the Communist Party and simply demanded that the play not be produced. 13 days before opening night, it was banned. And it caused a huge stir, and I won't go into the details, but that's one example. And the final decision to not produce the play was made by Erich Honecker himself, the head of state. The most famous authors who remained in Germany and did not emigrate to the West, such as Volker Braun and Christa Wolf, had enormous dossiers which show how they constantly ran into trouble with the authorities, how they negotiated over every change in their texts, and sometimes won small victories, small enough to satisfy hardliners in the Communist Party, because you've got a party debate over Christa Wolf and Volker Braun, yet big enough to give the writers some sense of their own independence. Now, I don't have time to discuss all of these cases, but I'd like to mention one. This concerns the censoring of Christa Wolf's most famous work, Cassandra. She was, as some of you know, although none of my students have ever heard of any of these people, the Cold War seems such a long time ago, Christa Wolf was really the most respected and influential writer in East Germany. And therefore, she had great leverage in dealing with the censors. She wanted to remain in East Germany. She was a loyal socialist. But in the case of Cassandra, she insisted that the passages deleted by the censors be indicated by ellipses, dot, 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 within square brackets. So if you will see on the upper left corner, there is, sure enough, a square bracket with three dots. That indicated that a passage had been deleted. But Christa Wolf also got permission for an uncensored copy of her book to be published in West Germany. And the West Germans took all of the censored passages, typed them out on small bits of paper, and slipped them to friends in East Germany. I was given seven pieces of paper like that, and you can see from this slide, you see the piece of paper, that is the deleted passage. So you slip it into the book, and when you read the book and come across the ellipsis dots, the passage sort of explodes as especially provocative. If it had not been censored, it would hardly have been noticed. So in other words, you can watch the system at work and attempts to get around, to maneuver around the obstacles to free expression. What finally put an end to censorship in East Germany? Well, Christoph Hein, one of these rather dissident type writers, demanded its abolition in a Congress of the Authors Union in 1987. And the union voted to end censorship, although, of course, the regime never admitted that it existed. The regime at that meeting agreed in principle. But then Höpke and his team continued nonetheless to censor books for the next 2 years. I found the evidence in the archives. How then did censorship end? By the fall of the wall, an uprising. Finally, I would like to discuss censorship in British India during the 19th century. I'll move pretty fast. Am I doing okay for time, Peter? Okay. It turned on a fundamental but unacknowledged contradiction between imperialism and liberalism. The imperialists who ran the British Raj in India were liberals, and they applied policies devised by the most famous liberals of the 19th century. James Mill, John Stuart Mill, who worked for the East India Company, Thomas Babington Macaulay, and John Morley, who was elected with the Liberal government in 1905, and had written a biography of Gladstone, the supreme liberal of the 19th century. These men and the members of the India Civil Service believed in the freedom of the press. It was a fundamental principle in their liberal creed, which went back to 1695 and the abolition of pre-publication censorship. British law, including that principle, along with other liberal principles such as trial by jury, was incorporated in the government of the Raj. Yet the British governed by force, and the contradiction between their monopoly of power and their liberal values surfaced at times of conflict. So here is one example of the conflict from the mid-century years. It's the title page of a Bengali play translated into English known as the Indian Uncle Tom's Cabin, Neil Durpan. It was a melodrama that exposed the exploitation of Indian peasants by British landowners in the very important indigo industry. At first, it was a spectacular hit in Calcutta's vibrant popular theater district. Then the play circulated as a pamphlet in Bengali and finally was published in an English translation in 1861. A man called James Long, a missionary who was sympathetic to the peasants, arranged for the publication. The landowners, these indigo planters, were horrified, in large part because the English edition was likely to reach critics of the industry in Britain. So they brought Long to trial for libel. Although it was not clear how a fictitious work could slander a group of unnamed citizens. Well, Long went to prison, and the trial stood as a warning that repression could operate effectively through the courts. After the Great Uprising of 1857, which some Indian historians call the First Indian Revolution, the British realized that in order to hold on to power, they needed to understand the natives, as they called them, not just to defeat them in battle. Newly organized as an administrative system, the India Civil Service conducted surveys of everything imaginable: population, topography, agriculture, industry, and books. By 1865, the ICS, India Civil Service, was churning out quarterly reports known somewhat misleadingly as catalogs, covering every single book published in every Indian language. They were actually printed, but they circulated secretly and only to authorized people in the India Civil Service. True to their liberal traditions, when the Raj officials wanted to find out what the natives were up to when they produced literature, they did not exert pre-publication censorship. They merely exercised oversight. They accumulated enough evidence that could be used in times of crisis, if necessary, to close presses and imprison authors by means of court action against seditious libel, as in the case of James Long. So the practice conformed exactly, I believe, to Michel Foucault's formula about the exercise of power in the 19th century: surveillance and punishment, surveiller et punir. The catalogs for the period 1868 to 1905 cover 200,000 titles, more by far than were produced in France during the entire 17th and 18th centuries. They organized information systematically by grouping entries into 16 columns, which covered subjects such as author, publisher, language, and press run. But the really interesting column is number 16 on the far right. It was headed Remarks. And these remarks grew and grew over the years until they became virtual book reviews, and they spilled over column 16, as you can see here, covering most of the rest of the page. So in reading column 16, you can read the discourse on native literature by the imperial power. And these remarks illustrate, I think, the cultural distance between the Victorian British and the indigenous Indian mentalities, especially when they came to one of the favorite themes in much of the literature, Krishna's dallying with the milkmaidens. It was described in one report as, quote, the most openly vulgar and obscene observations ever made, not even having the semblance of an excuse for the public good. It should be at once suppressed, end quote. But it was not suppressed. Despite these protests that appeared in column 16, the Raj rarely suppressed books. They did not make use of the information they accumulated until things fell apart. But at that point, surveillance turned into punishment. When nationalist agitation became violent after the partition of Bengal in 1905, the masters of India arrested authors and publishers on a large scale and condemned them to prison for fomenting sedition, even though in some cases, their books had circulated freely for many years. One was published in 1838. It circulated for 70 years with no difficulty, and it was banned as seditious in 1909. So I hold with those literary critics who say the meaning of a work is deeply contextual. But first, in accordance with British law, the offenders had to be put on trial. Now, the records of these trials are fascinating to read. They read like hermeneutic battles because the defense lawyers, they were Indians trained in British law schools and in the Raj, cited Shakespeare, cited Sidney, while arguing that the prosecution had misunderstood the texts. A proper knowledge of Sanskrit roots, they claimed, proved the innocence of passages that the prosecution deemed to be seditious. For example, the defense of the prosecution disputed the meaning of a key line in a Bengali poem as it was translated into English for the court. It sounded like nonsense in English because it was translated literally, and therefore it provided an opportunity for the lawyers to exercise their exegetical powers. According to the prosecution, it meant drive the British out of India. According to the defense attorney, the original should have been interpreted according to its Sanskrit root and Bengali syntax, notably, quote, the seventh case with the force of the nominative, end quote, and therefore it meant, quote, status and rewards these days go only to businessmen, therefore go into business, end quote. So the prosecution says, rise up and throw out the English. The defense says, get rich, go into business. Things like that are occurring all the time. But in every case I studied, the prosecution won, the authors and publishers went to prison, and the judges congratulated the court for suppressing sedition while upholding the liberty of the press. Well, having got to know these three systems of censorship from the inside, can one ask questions about censorship in general? Far from being the same thing everywhere and at all times, it is varied according to the character of each regime. It should be studied, I believe, ethnographically as an ingredient in a political culture and not as the villain of a story which always has the same plot, repression versus liberty. In all three cases, one can see how political cultures crystallized around core principles, privilege, surveillance, and planning. In each one, censorship pervaded every aspect of literary life and shaped literature itself as a cultural system within the socio-political order. It took place at the everyday level through a constant process of interpretation, compromise, complicity, and negotiation. Does censorship, therefore, involve constraints of every kind, including the marketplace as understood by Marxists, the subconscious as studied by Freudians, and every speech act as analyzed by literary theorists. According to one theorist, maybe you know him, Stanley Fish, quote, "There's no such thing as freedom of speech, and it's a good thing too," end quote. So when I ask my students to give examples of this kind of censorship, not the big Hitlerian Stalinist kind, they come up with examples such as wearing a necktie, or not wearing a necktie, or brushing your teeth at night, or calling a professor, professor. But if censorship is everything, then it is nothing. The postmodernist view trivializes it. I think we should take seriously the testimony of authors who suffered from censorship under the communist regimes during the Cold War. Alexander Solzhenitsyn in Russia, Milan Kundera in Czechoslovakia, Czesław Miłosz in Poland, Norman Manea in Romania, Danilo Kiss in Yugoslavia, they all wrote accounts of how they experienced censorship during the Cold War, how it actually operated, and how it operated especially within their own minds. There's an East German novelist, he specialized in detective stories, called Erich Löst, and he said, "There's a little green man in my ear, and whenever I write something, he says to me, 'Are you sure you want to write that? That could get you in trouble.'" So self-censorship, I think, is at the heart of any system. So I take this testimony from people who recently operated under censorship in the Soviet system as an argument against the postmodernist trivialization of the concept of censorship. In my own conception, censorship concerns power, especially power monopolized by the state or in some cases the church, rather than power as constraints of every kind. But in taking up this position, I must confront what could be called the anthropologist's dilemma. When anthropologists go into the field, as I'm sure many of you know, they attempt to be neutral and to engage in a dialogue with the people they study, yet they often run into practices that horrify them, such as female circumcision. No matter how hard they try, they cannot suspend their own values or avoid the pull of ethnocentrism. Now, I admit that there is an ethnocentric element in my own attempt to take an anthropological view. Despite the scorn of literary critics for, this is what Stanley Fish calls, First Amendment pieties, I subscribe to the principle of freedom of speech as it is guaranteed by the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. Yet, of course, at the same time, I recognize the culture-bound character of that commitment because the First Amendment, the U.S. Constitution, does not extend beyond the boundaries of the United States. Of course, the principle of freedom of expression can be found in other political cultures, many of them, along with the same tension between relativism and commitment. So, what should we conclude? In my view, we need to understand censorship, not merely to condemn it. But while making an attempt at understanding, I think we must also take a stand, especially today when the state, with help from Google and Facebook, is watching every move we make. Thank you.
Borrow the microphone and thank you for that wonderful presentation and invite members of the audience to step up to the mic here in the center of the aisle if you have questions or comments that you'd like to share with Professor Darnton. There's no need to be shy.
Thank you. Thank you for a wonderful talk, and also for books like The Great Cat Massacre, which had a profound impact on me in my own writing. It's always also wonderful to meet someone from the school of Goffman. So let me ask you an Irving Goffman type of question, and also follow that up with a Randall Collins type of question. He is one of your former colleagues at Princeton. Goffman would say, well, isn't there some performativity in there? Are censors performing for themselves or for an audience? Are writers performing, as you just so ably illustrated? Are writers performing for censors? Could you take that kind of higher level approach to looking at censorship? I'll stop at the first question.
I love the question, and I think it's absolutely valid. Goffman did love the performative quality of behavior, which often communicated meanings that were quite different from the ostensible meaning of the statement. So were the censors performing for one another? I think they were, in the case of East Germany, quite explicitly. You know, they discussed the plan, and they were trying to score points. They had disputes among themselves. One of them even denounced another and forced that person out. But it's more than a power struggle. It's also a performance, I agree. And I think that that you couldn't say, though, that they performed in front of the East German public because they were supposed not to exist. No one knew where their office was except the powers in the Communist Party. But there was, I think, an element of performance when their boss, Klaus Herpke, went over to this separate building, which was the headquarters of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, and had to have a debate with the people in Kultur. Unfortunately, we don't have minutes of that debate, or at least I didn't find them in the archives. So I don't know how performative that was. But I would suspect that people would score points by nailing Herpke when they went over his plan inside the culture department of the party. So yes, I mean, I should have taken the performative element more seriously and run with it, as no doubt Goffman would have done. But thank you for the suggestion.
My follow-up question is a la Randall Collins, who is most famous for his genealogies of philosophy and intellectual influence. Would you say that the censors have lines of genealogical relation? Is it possible to say, well, the censors in this country, in this culture, looked over at this other time and place and were influenced by the way they did things back there or over there, but no, we're seeing ourselves more in the line of development of this kind of censorship? Or is it more dispersed and locally developed, as you seem to be arguing?
Another good question. It's quite right to say I'm arguing about sort of local cultures or cultures within a particular system. And I didn't find, but I didn't look for references to other systems of censorship. I think I mentioned this to the East German censors and said, well, you've got ancestors in 18th century France. And I mentioned the case of a man called Malesherbes, who is the head of the censorship office and was really a wonderful person who opened up all kinds of liberties within the old regime system for controlling books. They weren't all that interested, actually, but they felt a little bit edified. In the case of British India, yes, because they did go back to the abolition of pre-publication censorship in 1695. They were very aware of John Locke. They knew about Areopagitica. all of this apparatus that was inherited from the late 17th, the mid to late 17th century was present in their minds and also in the minds of their opponents in these court cases where Milton would be cited to defend the ostensible offender. So, yes, there were traces of a sense of genealogies, to put it that way. But, you know, I wasn't actually looking for that as much as I should have. So had my own sensitivity been sharper, I might have found more traces of it. And that would be, I think, an interesting direction to take a comparative history of censorship, because we have lots of regimes who are indulging in all kinds of censorship. You know, I'm only talking about books and literature, but if you get into the internet and television and so on, I mean, that's really very elaborate.
I actually want to follow up on that one. It's very, the illustration actually comes on this mediation side. I did a research project on Hemingway translations in the Soviet Union and in the language that I study, Estonian. They were waiting for the Russian translation to appear before they dared to do the Estonian translation, because they assumed that the right cuts would have been made, because For Whom the Bell Tolls is a very dangerous book. Remember, there are, you know, Soviets in that book. Hemingway wrote about the Soviet advisors in the Spanish Civil War. And so it was a dangerous book for 20 years. Nobody dared to translate that before those right cuts had been made. And the things that they ended up cutting out were really funny things, like the fact that Soviet commissars had bad teeth. But they didn't dare to touch the book before the right cut had been made. So there is certainly in the Soviet system a sense of a certain, you know, comparing against the Moscow edits and then doing your own. And often the local censors were overcorrecting, so to say, just not to be found short. So just a comment.
Yes, thank you. That's fascinating. And I'm sure that everyone within the Soviet Empire had their eye on Moscow. What's ironic, however, was that these East German censors told me that by the late 1980s, the U.S. was not a problem for them at all. The problem was Russia. That they were horrified by the things that the Russians permitted. And they cited the example of Sputnik. I don't know if you remember the magazine Sputnik, but it was full of quite, so to speak, liberal ideas. And they even had an expression for it within the censorship office, SU literature, Soviet Union literature. And they were horrified by it and sometimes tried to keep it out of East Germany, which was a far more Stalinistic regime than Russia itself in its last years.
If I may ask, what do you think about the censorship, if any, in the United States in the 30s? Was it strictly the Hayes Office and pornography? Or because I don't really remember too much of any other kind of censorship. What's the story?
I hate to disappoint you, but I don't know the story. I mean, I know it in principle, and of course there is the story of the McCarthy years as well. I think we could find many examples of censorship within our own history. During World War I, of course, war conditions are special, but there was a tremendous purge of all kinds of German literature, and in many places the German language was not allowed. There's a famous example of Huckleberry Finn being banned in Boston by the library, but the library got money from the municipality. Textbooks are modified for the council that passes on textbooks in Texas, a huge market for textbooks, and textbook publishers are very conscious of the right-wing nature of this group that has to approve the textbooks. But as I was mentioning at lunch with some of the students, they also wanted the approval of the councils for textbooks in California, which were more to the left. So these are government-appointed bodies. And as soon as you've got such bodies interfering with the circulation of things, I think you get censorship. So I agree. It certainly has existed in various forms in the United States. But I'm afraid I only want to speak for instances, systems, which I myself have investigated by a lot of time in the archives. Otherwise, I just have an opinion like everyone else. It's worth what it's worth.
At the risk of making the room too crowded, with Bill having already brought back in Irving Goffman and added Randall Collins, I want to add Max Weber. And in your account, you talked about the corporate nature of the French Ancien Régime censors. But Weber's account of bureaucracy and bureaucratization, it seems to me, connects them as well to both the Indian Civil Service, which was a highly meritocratic, selected by one of the first really systematic Western meritocratic exams, as well as these highly educated but parteilich East German censors. What's the role of bureaucrats as a separate corporate group with their own values and standards and career incentives that you see in these three groups, these three instances?
Well, I'm also a great fan of Max Weber, and there's a kind of Weberian spin on everything I've been saying. And as to bureaucracy, I mean, clearly the French developed it with the word itself. So then maybe the next step, and one which I haven't pursued as far as I might, would be to understand how it's self-referential and how it is a kind of iron cage in which the censors are developed. The thing is, it wasn't quite as highly developed as the bureaucracies that Weber observed later. For example, the censors didn't have offices. They worked out of their private apartments. They didn't have salaries. They played a game of patronage and prestige, fundamentally. But you've got the beginnings of a sort of bureaucracy, and certainly the paperwork makes it look that way. So I would say, you know, we're at a sort of early stage in the bureaucratization of this kind of function. By the time you get to, the British Raj, as you say, the India Civil Service was a remarkable group of highly trained men who had learned many different Indian languages, and the district officers, you know, really knew their way around. Maybe they're celebrated more than they deserve, but, you know, compared with the kind of administration under these princelings and rajas before that, they do indeed represent bureaucratization. The catalogs look like it, don't they? They've got, it's all organized into columns. There is a system of classification and an attempt to control reality by fitting it, slotting it into categories that I would connect with the bureaucratization. Now, in the case of East Germany, yeah, absolutely. I mean, these are people making careers. And you can see in the reading, especially in the archives, the attempt of people to advance in careers with lots of tensions connected with it. So I think the Weberian notion of bureaucratization works quite well.
I'm afraid that it falls to me to act as censor here call this part of the proceedings to a close, but I'd like to invite you to step up and speak informally if you didn't get a chance to ask it, any questions that you might have of Professor Darnton. But in the meantime, I would also like to invite the free expression of your appreciation for this wonderful